Waalaikumsalam.
Hello all participants. Happy Monday, and it is nice to be here and discuss about remote sensing and disaster risk management. As we know that reducing disaster risk is one of the steps to achieve the SDGs, especially goal number 11, achieving sustainable cities and communities, and goal number 13, the climate action. And I am Bijo Narko, and I will be the moderator for the International Lecture Series today. Before we start the meeting, I would like to introduce the presenters here. First one is Professor Yosafat Totuko Sri Sumantyo, PhD, from the Center for Environmental Remote Sensing, Chiba University. And the second one is Dr. Anang Wahyu Sejati from Geomatic Planning Laboratory, Department of Urban and Regional Planning, Diponegoro University. Prof. Yosafat is the leading researcher in remote sensing. He got his bachelor's degree in 1995 and master's degree in 1997, and got his doctoral degree in 2002 at Chiba University. And he became professor at Chiba University in 2013. His main research is in radar technology, and he invented the microstrip antenna, the circularly polarized synthetic aperture for unmanned aerial vehicle, small satellite, and three-dimensional radar for weather forecasting. He has many remarkable publications that are published in internationally recognized journal. And Dr. Anand is the young researcher that focusing in remote sensing and GIS. However, he has some publication that has been published in internationally recognized journal. Dr. Anna took the bachelor degree in 2003 and got his doctoral degree in 2019 at Diponegoro University. And now he is a lecturer at the Diponegoro University. Okay. This meeting today will be divided into four sessions. The first session is an opening remark by Prof. Wiwandari Handayani as the head of Department of Urban and Regional Planning. And the second session is the lecturing session by Professor Yosafat and Dr. Anang. The third session is question and answer and discussion. And the last session is the closing session. For the first session, I invite Prof. Wiwandari to open this ILS and give a brief opening remark. Please, Prof. Wiwandari, maybe you can open and give a opening remark. Please, Prof. Wiwandari.
Yeah, thank you very much, Pak Koko. So, can you hear my voice clearly?
Yes, yes, it is.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. All our speakers, yeah, Professor Yosafat, also Pak Anang, yeah, my colleague from Urban and Regional Planning Department, and the moderators, and also all participants. Please allow me to take this opportunity to give a brief opening, as now our sessions would be quite special because this would be our last session for the International Lecture Series for 2022, hoping that we can continue again for the next year in the 2023. And I would like also to take this opportunity to give my high appreciation to Professor Yosafat. It's really nice to meet you virtually now, and I hope maybe sometimes in the future I can meet you in person. Thank you very much that you would contribute and also give time, yeah, to be part of our International Lecture Series program. Personally, I hope that because our department is divided into several different laboratories, and we have one focusing on also remote sensing and its related modeling and in regard to the urban and regional planning, we hope that we can continue, yeah, the discussion and also the collaboration in the following years. And I believe Pak Anang, also as the head of the laboratory, will be very much in keen, yeah, to also develop the collaboration. And other thing that I would like to say for my brief opening now is that I'm very happy to check that actually in the end we already completed 7 international lecture series, and we have invited as professors and scholars from different continents, yeah, from the Australia, from the Queensland University, and then we also invite scholars from Europe. We have one from the TU Darmstadt in Germany. We have some others, yeah, from Japan before Professor Yosafat, also from Chiba University, and some few others. And we hope these programs can give a more international exposure for our students and also for department in general. Another thing that maybe also I would like to remind everybody that we also connect all the YouTube record, and everything is freely accessed via our website. So feel free, most especially for the students, to listen again, and hopefully that you will get some benefits here from this all lecturing series, and including today that we have focusing on the remote sensing and in regard to, of course, in the urban and regional planning issues and concept development. Yeah, I think that's all. Again, thank you, Prof. Yosafat. Thank you, Pak Anang, and also all the team who already arranged our lecture series program. Hope we will have a nice session and discussion. And thank you also, Pak Koko. I'll offer again to you back. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you, Prof. Iwi, for the brief opening remark, but promising the sustainability of the ILS in the next year. Thank you, Prof. Iwi. Okay, well, we have come to the main session to see the role of remote sensing in urban planning, especially in disaster risk management. There are 2 topics here. Prof. Yosafat will be presenting the remote sensing technology and its application in disaster risk management. And after Prof. Yosafat done, Dr. Anang will be presenting the method of combining Google Earth Engine and spatial analysis in disaster risk management later. Okay, each presenter will have 30 minutes of time to present their presentation. For the first session, Prof. Yosafat, would you like to present the lecture material?
Okay, thank you very much. First to Bapak Wijanarko and also Professor Wiwandari Handayani, and also Bapak Anang Wahyu Sejati, and all of the participants. First is, before I start my talk, is may I say Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Hari ini saya akan sampaikan, maaf, ini saya akan share. Apakah kelihatan sudah?
Ampun, Bro, sudah.
Ampun, oke, siap. Saya akan mulai pertama sebagai perkenalan singkat, ya. In English is okay, yeah. Okay, yes. My name is Yosafat Tutuko Sri Sumantyo. Now as I'm as the professor at Center for Environmental Remote Sensing, Chiba University, and also at the Department of Electrical Engineering of Universitas 11 Maret. And right now is I'm also the head of Department of Environmental Remote Sensing at the Graduate School of Science and Technology, and also head division that I manage 3 department in Chiba University. And yes, I arrange some of the program for the WG program, such a stay program, long stay program, and I hope some of you can join our program. And right now is we already have the student WG program with Institute of Technology Bandung and Universitas Indonesia and Universitas Gajah Mada. And now we we plan to run with the Institute Teknologi 10 November and also Universitas Udayana. I hope next with the Universitas Diponegoro that we know that Universitas Diponegoro is also our sister university. And please use this opportunity that some of the student and young scientists, young lecturer from the UNDIP can learn in our department, especially in my laboratory. And like already mentioned, maybe, yes, that I'm also the leader of the IEEE Geoscience and Remote Sensing Society, especially for the Instrumentation and Future Technology Technical Committee for the Unmanned Aerial Vehicle. And today I want to show you some of our results that we already developed some of the radar, yes, for the future technology. And we just, it's not just develop the system for the our planet, the Earth. But now we are also develop some of the sensor for the lunar. It means the moon and also for the Mars. Yes, I hope we can move to the moon and also the Mars in the future. Okay, this is the sensor that we develop in my laboratory. You can see here in the development of the multi-platform microwave remote sensor and the application. Today, I want to show you some of the sensor that we already developed in my laboratory. We developed from the unmanned aerial vehicle, and this is my UAV-2 that will span 6 meters. We have the name is GX1 and GX2. GX is mean Yosafat Laboratory Experimental Unmanned Aerial Vehicle 1 and 2. And we have the payload is about 25 until 35 kilogram, and we also develop on the from the aircraft CN-235 aircraft and Boeing 737. And in my laboratory, Yosafat Microwave Remote Sensing Laboratory or GMRSL, now we also develop our own satellite that we can observe globally. Yeah. Okay. Today I want to show you is more, you know, more compact information. Yeah, it is the activity of the IEEE. I hope you can join it. IFT, yes, Instrumentation and Future Technology. Yes, and now I'm wrote the book, and I hope next December, next month, will publish by the CRC. Yes, it is asked us by the IEEE. Now we work together with the IEEE, and I hope it is you can find a very complete information in the system of the synthetic aperture radar. Yeah, and yes, it is based on our experiment and our experience to design, manufacturing, testing. Yes, and also the flight and some of the application. It is very, very completed from A to Z of the synthetic aperture radar technology. And I'm also have I also manage the Facebook and LinkedIn. Please also join this SNS system. This is my book. Yes, I wrote noise to be in the 16 or 17 books. Yes, I hope from next year I hope could wrote book in Indonesian. Yeah, including the electromagnetics. Yeah, and some of the basic knowledge, because I'm teaching at Universitas 11 Maret, and I hope my textbook is can, you know, publish in Indonesian. I have just 2 book in Indonesian right now. Yes, I hope I can increase some books in Indonesian later. Okay, today I want to talk about the synthetic aperture radar. Yes, the background objective needs. Yes, and then the concept itself, and then the theoretical. It is in the scattering study, and also the benefit, characteristic, design system, and ground test and flight test. Yeah, and later in the final is I want to show you some the application. Yeah. I think you know about the synthetic aperture radar. Yes, it is the sensor that we can penetrate the cloud. Yeah, and then we can get the information is in clear without the you know the cloud information. And you can operate this sensor in the nighttime. Yeah, and I think some of the aerospace agency in the world is like the DLR of the Germany, and also here is the Memphis and Dozar is by the Germany, and also DLR this one in the Germany, and then it is in the NASA itself, and also the JAXA in the Japanese Aerospace Agency, and then here is ONERA in the France, yes, and here Intermap is by the United States, yes, and here is by Australia. But unfortunately, all is working in a linear polarization that use the horizontal polarization and vertical polarization. And now I invented, I have the only one in the world is circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar. Yeah, it is my own sensor that we put in the CN-235 aircraft, and also the Boeing 737 the aircraft. Yeah. Okay. Today I want to talk about the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar. It is my system. It is mine. Yeah. Me, and it is when the system that I put in the Boeing 737, and here is CN-235, and here in the Cessna, and here is for also from the my UAV. Yes. It is the L band, and also it is my micro satellite. Yeah. And yes, we spend much money. Yes, about to develop in my laboratory of JMRSL. And here we call it the multi-platform synthetic aperture radar, especially circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar, onboard UAV, aircraft, high altitude platform system, hubs, yeah, and also the micro satellite. Yeah. And the application, it says we need the system for the disaster monitoring, natural resources monitoring, and then search and rescue, home security, anti-terrorism. Yes, tomorrow, yeah, I will talk with the our Minister of the Defense, Bapak Prabowo Subianto, and also Kaso. Yes, we want to talk about what is the best one for the Indonesia. Yes, I think one of the sensor that managed by the us, yes, anak bangsa is, I think, is one in this circularly polarized synthetic aperture. And also for the infrastructure, I think it is close to your field that we can use this sensor is for the maintenance of the highway, railway, electricity transmission line, and housing, and so on. Yeah, and our city. Yeah, and we also we already applied our technology to monitor the Malay Peninsula. We had the project with the Malaysian government, yes, with the Japanese government to monitor the landslide along the Malay Peninsula. Yeah, and I hope also in Indonesia, especially in Semarang, I think we already also made the observation of the land subsidence along the you know the coastal line of the Semarang city. Yeah, it's in the concept of the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar. You can see here, we put in the aircraft on the platform, and then we transmit the circular polarized with the polarization is right-handed on the left-handed, and then scattered based on the condition of the object itself, and then we process this two scatter, yeah, the left-handed and also the right-handed. And it is my patents, a number of the patent. It is my only one in the world, the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar. And for the detail, you can also read this our paper here. It is free of charge, it's open access. Just put the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar. Yeah. And I'm also wrote the book, and I hope from the next December you can also access my books. Yeah, and it is the image of the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar CPSAR, and it is in the optic. You can compare. It is can penetrate the cloud, and we can get a very clear image when the resolution is 37.5 centimeter. Okay, and next is okay, sorry, I cannot look. Okay, it is in the theory. Yes, based on the scattering of the circular polarization, it is in the circular transmitter, and then when scatter is changed, yes, from the circular to the elliptical polarization, and then linear polarization, and then change to the circular polarization. But you can see here, left-handed and right-handed. It is the combination, yeah. And you can use this theory for the future new observation technique, yes, from the ground, including the observation of the urban area. Okay, this is from the detail of the scattering that this is, you know, you can see the transverse, yes, and also the parallel scattering of the, you know, reflection and also the transverse. It means scattering from the object and also the transverse because penetrate. And you can get the data based on this information. Yeah. Okay, I want to skip this one. And it is the acceleration the most important in circular polarized synthetic aperture radar. And if possible, is you we can observe is less than 3 dB. Yes, along around this area with the incident angle is the better one is about less than 50 degree. Yeah. From the former of the linear polarization, it is very big problem when you observe with the very small of nadir angle. So, but using the circular polarization, we can get it more clear, yes, and we can split and classify the data more better using the Excel ratio image, yeah, because we can get a more accurate and high precision of the data. The benefit of the circular polarization is good from the low incident angle, like I already mentioned. And then, if you use, you know, the linear polarization, for example, the horizontal polarization, we put on the aircraft and then transmit horizontal. But unfortunately, if the aircraft is affected by the turbulence, you know, the you know, the condition of the aircraft is changed, you know, the linear polarization to be like this one, the horizontal, and you receive the horizontal like this one is have the misalignment. Yeah, so in, if you use the circular polarization, you transmit circular and you get the circular. It is we can reduce the effect of the misalignment. And if we put the microsatellite, we can also you know, reduce the effect of the Faraday rotation. It is a big problem when you use the linear polarization when we through the atmospheric, especially in the ionospheric layer. You can compare it in the linear polarization and the circular polarization. Co-polarization is strong, but cross-polarization is low. Yeah, it is from the linear polarization. But if you use the circular polarization, you can see here, it is in the co-polarization is strong, and here in the cross-polarization also strong. It means when you put on the aircraft, even your aircraft is have the some effect of the turbulence, but you can keep the data is in clear data. Yeah, and it is one example of the application. You can also derive the axial ratio images and also the elliptical angle images. So if you want to observe the vegetation, tree, forest, and also the like the cool area, yes, or the lahan gambut, yes, this is, I think you can also get I think more precise using the circular polarized radar that I invented. For this is from the UAV, you can also get my paper in International Journal of Remote Sensing, and the other one is many in IEEE Geoscience and Remote Sensing letter, or GRS, sorry, TGRS, and also JSTAR. Okay. Okay, we develop our sensor by ourselves in my laboratory, GMRSL, and also here in the antenna, we also develop by ourselves, and we install in the aircraft by ourselves, and we operate it by ourselves. Yeah, so this is from A until Z, is we all is developed by ourselves. Yeah, and from the detail is you can read in my books. Yes, it is from the aircraft, and here is from the UAV. Like shown here, we you know, flying and transmit like this one and get the data. Yeah, okay. This is from the characteristic of the images that you know, with the height is 1,000 until here is 4,000 in the near range. Yes, it is how many kilometers that we can observe. Yes, we must, you know, calculate first when before we meet the flying mission. Yeah, and then here is also the of nadir angle. Yes, you need to also to observe when we want to get more precise information. And from, I'm sorry, I talked about the technical, you know, technique about how to observe the circular polaris synthetic aperture radar. And it is also the sweat itself, because it is very important when you want to make the process of the azimuth compression. Yes, from the range compression is it is very important. Yeah, but it is for the azimuth compression. Yeah, and next is we need to calculate about how many memory, how many giga, how many 100 giga or tera. Yes, when we observe. So in this case, you must know about the geometric of this synthetic aperture. I think it's, you cannot find in some books. Yeah, but in my book is I wrote in very detail. Yeah, and you can also develop by your own the synthetic aperture radar sensor for example, dedicated for the urban observation or for the coastal city. Yes, it is also possible. Yeah. Okay, PRF, yeah, number of the pulse repetition frequency that we when we want to derive the, you know, the data is more detailed and get the signal to noise ratio is very good. We need to know about the PRF itself. Yeah. Okay, yes, I want to skip this one. And finally, it is in the spec of my sensor. The most important is the outlook angle is 56 degree. Yeah, and then the platform, we operated in 1 kilometer altitude, and velocity is based on the velocity of the aircraft, CN235 aircraft, and also this the bandwidth is 200 until 400 in our case. Yeah, so why we got 37.5 centimeter of the resolution. Yeah, and then the transmitting power, it is when we did the design and we manufacture our system is 250 watt. Yeah, but unfortunately, we got some of the problem with our system, and we just transmitted 20 watt. But still, we got the data is very good. It means we make the observation is more, you know, better if we got the if we use a full, you know, power. Yeah, 250 watt. Yeah. Okay, and the other one is sweat rate itself, 750 meter. Yes, the you know the length on the size of the image. Yeah. Okay, and this is the system of the our sensor. Yeah, it is you can see here mainly in the SAR processing unit is composed by in the here in the chirp generator. Yeah. The pulse, the chirp itself is very important to adjust the resolution. Yeah, so it is arbitrary wave generator. Yeah, especially from the chirp generator, and then chirp generator is connect to the amplifier here transmitter inside here, and then connect to the TX, yeah, transmitter antenna. After transmit, scatter, and then we receive using the antenna, and then receiver here in the low noise amplifier, and then digitizer. Yeah, digitizer is to get, you know, the data from the analog to the digital. Yeah, after that we save to the RAM storage, and then we make the you know processing. For the detail of the system is you can see here. Yes, it is upon the antenna workstation. And time control unit transmitter connect to the antenna here, transmitter, and here if antenna from the receiver hand contact here from the receiver is the low noise amplifier, and then we make the process inside this work station. The antenna itself, you also developed by my student now working in Brin, yeah, and it is 400 megahertz of the bandwidth, yeah. Okay, next. I'm still have 10 minutes, yeah. Okay, here before we put on the aircraft, we need to do the some of the experiment inside our anechoic chamber. Yes, first is the output power. We need to check this power is right. We can transmit 250 watt or not? Yeah. But yes, we got is very a good you know result. Yes, that our system is working very well. Yeah. And then here in the choppers, yeah, here in the chopper that we transmit, and then we make the compression and the range, yeah, and then you can get it is one of the chop compress information. It is so representative of one pixel. Yes, one pixel is look like this one. Yeah, okay, and then next. We did the loop back, you know, it is in the transmitter, yes, for 200 megahertz with the here in the width of the pulse itself is 5 microsecond, and then transmit. After that, we got the receive pulse, and then we made the matching filter, and then you can get a very nice, you know, chirp pulse, yeah. And after that, we do. We did, you know, experiment. We put inside the aircraft, ESC-N235, the aircraft of the Squadron 5 of the Indonesian Air Force. And then it is the antenna that we developed together with my student. And then the frame is managed by the Indonesian Air Force. Yeah. And here in the system that we put in our you know aircraft, it is in the GMRSL of one the transmitter, receiver, and even the controller and the GPS, and also from the IMU itself. Yeah. Okay. And then we did the flight like this one. Yes. And the antenna is installed like this one. Before the flight is we must know about the spec of the radome itself, because the radome is have you know the impact on the actuator you know effect for the wave propagation. So we want to know about how many effect, yeah. And then we made the experiment like shown here. We transmit like here, you know, LL, yes, we transmit L and receive L, yeah. And then LR is more higher. We transmit right-handed and we receive left-handed, yeah. And then opposite, yeah, we transmit left-handed and receive the right-handed, yeah. And then RR, yeah, transmit and receive is right-handed, yeah. Okay, and then you can get it is in the data is very nice and resolution is also very nice. And then we put three corner reflector, yes, here, yeah, sorry, two corner reflector, yeah. And first is the LL, yes, it is low, yeah. And then RR, it is also low. And then you can see here, it in the LR, the cross polarization is very high, yeah. And here is also very high. It is same with my theory that prove that my theory in the cross polarization stronger than compared to the co-polarization for the circular, but it is compared to the linear polarization that the cross polarization is very low, but here in the cross polarization is very high, and then the co-polarization is also very high compared to the linear polarization. So it means it is very good if you use the circular polarization. Okay, from the details, you can read my paper in IEEE G-Star that talk about this experiment. Yeah. And next is about the radome effect. Yeah, without the radome and with the radome. And we can get the effect of the radome is 3.6 dB. It means about the half of the power is attenuated by the radome itself. And then we install our system in the aircraft. It's like shown here. And then we did the test, flight test, and we got the data. Yeah, it is in the system to process. Yeah, and then you can get the. It is in the first image of the circular polarization in the world. Yeah, so here is the only one, and our invented system. Yeah, compared to the optic sensor, we can penetrate and cut the data look like a three dimension. Yes, and very clear of the images. Compared to the another circular, the synthetic aperture, I think is CPSR is more better. Yeah. And you can zoom up, this area and zoom up, and you can get in this data. And we can penetrate to inside the houses, yeah. And you can get the pillar of the, the house is shown in this picture, yeah. And you can also know the change, on the different characteristic of the soil, yes, in the paddy field. Okay, that's the full polarimetric data. Yes, and if we zoom up, it's like shown here, LR until the RR itself. And here is the most better when the bandwidth is 400 megahertz and the resolution is less than 30 centimeter. And we can also observe the here in the ship, like shown here, it is in the optic and here in the synthetic aperture radar. And the system it can be operated in the nighttime, so you can find the illegal fishing, yeah, and illegal trespassing, or the ship that within the AIS is also possible, yeah. Okay, and yes, this is from the fishery, yes, like the ponds, yes. You can also observe using this synthetic aperture radar. And in the Pangkajene area, city, yeah, and the northern part of the Makassar. And you can find, it is very detailed of the boundary of the paddy field. Yes, compared to the other sun system, I think it is more clear. Yeah. Okay. Before I close my talk, yes, I think I still have 4 minutes. Yeah, and you can see here that there's circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar to observe the paddy. Yeah, I think one of the example. Of course, we can have the many example, but because my talk is not so many, so it is we met with my student experiment using the circular polarized synthetic aperture radar to observe the paddy. The growing of the paddy, yes. And here we use the paddy, yes. We grew up the paddy until the the ripening, yeah. And then we observe every week, yes, to know about the change of the scattering, yes. And we got shown here, yeah. And then based on the polarimetric SAR, yes, you can find the relationship on the entropy and the alpha, like shown here, it in the Bragg surface, yes, a scattering, and also the dipole scattering, dihedral scattering, and forest double bounds, yes, vegetation and rough propagation effect. It means you can make some the classification from the surface scattering and then the double bounds and also the volume scattering. Yeah, and then based on this result is here, for example, yeah, it is you can see in the circular polarization and circular polarization here in the full circular polarization and here in the dual circular polarization, and it is used in the full 4 modes and here just 2 modes, and you can see here you started from the with just on the water or nothing, and then you put the paddy, a seed, and then growing, and then the ripening, and you can make the classification like shown here using the entropy and the alpha angle relationship. And how about the dual circular polarization? And you can see just using the 2 mode, even using the 2 mode, and you still can get classified. But if we compare with the linear polarization. Dual linear polarization. What happened? And you can see, the distribution like shown here. You cannot, make the classification when we started the planting and when the growing and when the ripening. Yeah, it means you can use just 2 modes of the circular polarization to get the data of the information. If you want to use the circular polarization, the linear polarization, you need to the full polarimetry, yeah, and in 4, yeah. Even you use the dual with the circular polarization, it is still possible. I mean, the memory just half. Yeah, half is more, you know, if you observe many abundant of the information, I think better you use the small memory technique. I think the circular pronunciation is the dual circular pronunciation. I think it's for moment the best one. Okay, yes, the other one is the volume scattering, surface scattering, and double bonds, and you can see here the change of the, you know, full polarimetric and dual band, dual polarimetric, and you can see this is also meet the classification using this just the two mode, yeah. And this one is from nothing, yes. And then we put the seeding and growing like this one. And then you can use the circular pronunciation to observe the paddy. Especially in Indonesia, is we are in the, you know, the paddy the country. It means if you use this one, and you can get to estimate the volume of the paddy, and then you can make the estimation of the volume of the production of the paddy, yeah. Okay, for the future, and now we already developed some of our sensor, including for the micro satellite. And after 2022, we want to realize our drone with the flying time is about more than 1 hour. Then we want to put our system that the radar is more compact. Right now, the weight is less than 5 kilogram, and then we can put in our sensor, and then we can fly in more than 1 hour. And we also developed this one is the HAPS high altitude platform system, and then we can fly once is for the 6 months. It means we can to operate different with the satellite and also the aircraft. It is more efficient, and we can observe from the disaster, especially in the urban area. Please join the IEEE IFT, where I'm the leader of the remote sensing instrument for the UAV, and also join in my SNS if you want to know about the activity of me. Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, and I want to close my talk today. I'm sorry, offer 2 minutes about the allocation from time for me. Okay, if you want to contact me, please see my homepage or contact to this email address. Okay, thank you very much, and I give back the time to Papa Wijonarko. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Yosafat. It is very clear and detailed information about how to produce the CPSAR technology and how to develop the CPSAR instrument, and how to use the data from CPSAR technology to any field of research, and hope in the future we can obtain the data for free, so any student or any researcher can obtain more precise detailed data about the Earth surface for free, so they can make various research in Earth surfaces. Thank you, Mr. Prof. Yosafat. Give applause, please, for the clear and detailed information about the CPSAR from Prof. Yosafat. Thank you, Prof. Yosafat.
Thank you, Prof. Yosafat.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. And now it is Dr. Anang turns to present the method of combining Google Earth engine and spatial analysis in disaster risk management. Okay, Dr. Anang, you can start the presentation now, please.
Yeah, thank you, Pak Wijonarko and Prof. Yosafat Tuko. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, everyone. And today, I will talk about how the combining Google Earth Engine and spatial analysis in disaster assessment. Yes. In the previous explanation from Prof. Yosafat Tuko, it's very interesting that we get to know how to remote sensing data produced by some of the several instruments and developed by Prof. Yosafat is very interesting and very great research, Prof. with world-class level. And now I will talk about the planning perspective, how we as a planner, as a urban regional planner, use the remote sensing data from your tools, from your instrument, and maybe from the several provider of remote sensing data to how do the disaster risk reduction or disaster risk assessment in the several area in Indonesia. So let's start with this one. This is my records in the GIS and application and applied remote sensing for disaster research or maybe for applied geomatic research. Yeah. In the 2020, I'll try to quantify the impact of industrial using remote sense data using Sentinel-2B and 2A combined with some spatial analysis data. And then the second one is I try to develop how the open source web GIS as a framework for land use monitoring system in Balikpapan. So that is become a participation solution for developing countries with the low cost information system. And then from there, my several research that how remote sensing data in GIS can combine in disaster risk assessment. And then in this, this is my publication, publication in the some of high reputable journal. Yes. Maybe Professor Wat have a lot of publication in IEEE, and then I use it for this for applied geomatics in urban regional planning. So maybe someday we can. I hope we can combine by producing data from Projo Sapat with radar data, and then I try to use the radar data also for this presentation to combine with the sum of disaster risk assessment variable to get the risk assessment mapping, and then help us for create the decision support system about the how spatial planning can reduce the risk reduction for some disaster in Indonesia. So we start from data for future development planning process. As a planner, maybe as a planning school, we also familiar with the day one, the scheme that illustrate how the planning process, yeah, starting from the identifying issues, set goals, collect and interpret data, and then revise plan, and how to prepare plan for planning, and then evaluate impact and program review, and then, yes, this is a life cycle system. So we need to combine some variable to get the better planning or maybe to get the better program for our future development. So the point is, starting from 2015, we talk about the big data, talk about how the data gathering role and the change of data gathering role in the planning. So we need to how change our mindset to improve our data, our way to the collecting the data. For example, if sometimes we need to go to the sum of field of the planning area or maybe on the study area, yeah, to get in touch with a person in there. But yeah, for the disaster analysis, maybe for example, if we have to know about the disaster risk area or maybe disaster hazard area, we cannot keep in touch with the area. So we need the different way to how to approach the area or maybe how to approach and get the data for some analysis of disaster. So this is very important to change our mindset as a planner or spatial planner to go with, yes, this is more information about spatial data, one of which is how we get the spatial data from remote sensing. And then we can develop some of scenario that what if scenario is that we know, like if one condition happen and then they can impact the other activity or maybe have an impact with the other spatial role or maybe or spatial disaster. So this is one of the transformation role that making spatial planning open. Even though with some person with not a planning person, yeah, maybe like today, yeah, I'm not in for UFE production. Maybe Prof. Josapat can explain clearly about how data produced and how the instrument developed. So this is not for not only for the planner or maybe everyone that study about planning, but how the people can change the mindset about the spatial data set. So This is important because I know that there are several public work in Indonesia about spatial planning should be thinking different about the spatial access data. Why we use remote sensing data? So in Indonesia, we have a problem about the planning identical with the large area and limited time to preparing the planning document. Sometimes we just need 6 months until 8 months to develop the planning document and with maybe one regency, maybe only one province. So with the large area, we need to improve our data regulation system and maybe data gathering role to get the precision of the spatial information. Then we can go with some analysis about the maybe land use change process, maybe for future land use planning and so on, and related to the spatial aspect. And then the second one is how the search for time and cost efficiency. Like we know, yeah, if we go with some several area in Indonesia, yeah, this is so costly. And then we need to improve our knowledge here, but how to get the data with efficiency cost. So the data can be used by a planner, but we can with the sum of effort or less effort to get the analysis for spatial data. And the third one is some regional scale remote sensing data can be obtained for free. You know, from the regional scale, be familiar about USGS data from Landsat, and now be familiar about ESA from European Space Agency. They start or maybe they launch about Sentinel, starting from Sentinel-1. It is a SAR data, like the study from Professor Sapat. And then the Sentinel-2B based on the optic. Yeah. The Sentinel-1 is SAR data based on the radar sensor, and the Sentinel-2 A and B is based on the optical data. So there's some difference with Sentinel-1 and 2 from ESA. And then some of the open provider for maybe, for example, Planet and like the separate platform that provide the open access data for spatial in several resolution. Remote sensing data processing technology continues to develop. Like we know about the, how the Project Sapat continue develop a lot of instrument to get better accuracy, better classification with the image related to the Earth observation. So this is so interesting. Yeah, we attend for the future land use detection, Prof. Because I know that in your three last slide, you talk about how image classification, like cropland and so on. So this is so interesting for us as a planner. So we can get the advantages and able to recognize object without being direct contact, like I said before. So in certain condition, yeah, such as disaster, the method of utilization of remote sensing is common to reaches for survey or maybe for resources that not keep in touch with the some of the disaster area. Open data remote sensing with various scale is available. Yes, like I said before, so it can be adapted to the context of run to the study. For example, the context is how large you can plan, or maybe how large can you can analyze with the remote sense data with the open data for several provider. The one for the just for example, yeah, is several resolution. For example, the multispectral data. Multispectral data is from USGS, yeah. Landsat. The resolution is 30 meter. They can analyze or help us analyze the regional aspect or maybe the regional dynamic. Maybe if you want to work detail with this satellite imagery, cannot possible because it's impossible because they have 30 meter resolution. So if you want to analyze detail, you have to choose a different resolution or different type of scale of remote sensing data. And then we have the hyperspectral data resolution in the half meters. Yeah, this is an example from GOI, and then LIDAR sensor, UFV IRL imagery. Yes, maybe we used to UAV like drone, quadcopter, and fixed wing, and maybe the Prof. Joseph Pat product is one of the best in the world, yeah, Prof. Yeah, because they can not only capture the how the art aspect like crop land use and so on, but they can analyze several aspects in the art observation. And then we also know about the IFSAR or DIM or DTM, yeah, digital elevation model and digital surface terrain model. Yeah. This is from DEMNAS. DEMNAS is one of platform provided by Information Geospatial Agency of Indonesia that can help us to analyze the terrain, maybe the like the morphology of the sample area, so we can use it by 5 meter resolution. And then the DSM, this is direct from the aerial imagery also. Yeah, if we capture the aerial imagery by drone, for example, we can get some of data, maybe two data. The first one is imagery data, and then we have the point cloud data. Point cloud data consists of the some of the like elevation point, so we can create it and then combine it with the image data, so we can get the full of image that illustrate the 3D model or 2D model. That's the difference with DEM. DEM is only elevation and terrain, and DSM is surface. So surface is including the form of building, tree, and so on that can illustrate the activity about the Earth. So we go to the implementation in case study. I took the study in Tegal Regencies. Before I continue the explanation about the case study, like you know, this is derived from Landsat in the right one, yeah, from 1970 to 2020. We know that some of Java is in emergency because some urban areas develop, and especially in the north coastal and the south coastal area. And Tegal is one of the north. Part of North Coastal area of Java, and they located in the central Java. So the study is how Tegal can develop the plan based on the spatial risk assessment. This is the model because for determine the disaster risk map, we not only get the hazard or maybe a disaster area, we can derive it by the Google Earth Engine by combining the sum of Sentinel-1 data. But also we have to combine it with some of variable to determine the disaster risk level. Yeah. The first one is the disaster hazard map. Yes, we can derive it from the satellite imagery, maybe some of analysis with Google Earth Engine. And then we also combine it with a vulnerability map that consists of the social, cultural, economic, and physical and environment. And then after we got the two basic map, we have to count the disaster capacity because how to reduce the risk, we have to improve or maybe increase the capacity of the area. So the disaster capacity is so complex. Because we have to collect the primary data and keep contact with some of people or maybe key person or key stakeholder there, and then to get us, to get the assess to assess the for example if some area have the people then or maybe one of community disaster for related to disaster risk reduction, so this point is good. And then if some area they don't have a community for disaster risk reduction, so it is so bad, and there is a lot of we can assess with some of the scoring technique, so we can get the clear data about the capacity in the some area. So after we have the disaster hazard map, vulnerability map, and the capacity map, we can produce the disaster risk map, and then we can go to the how the policy projects, because the disaster policy, we talk about the disaster governance in Indonesia, because that's a problem with the how to manage the, or maybe how to manage the disaster reduction from the national level, province level, and then in the regency or city level. So we need to the same base map, or maybe the same reference about the disaster risk map to arrange the priority for the area to register the disaster risk. Okay, before we talk about the Earth Engine to produce the data, this is the remote sensing data and cloud computing. We know in the when I take the bachelor degree, we have to download the data and then process it from the several software that related to image interpretation. So with cloud computing, the data is already in the form of cloud system with the various resolution. So this is so helpful for us to get it easier to get the data for one area. So no need to download. Like I said before, we have to download it before we analyze. Now with cloud computing system, we can produce or analyze in the cloud computing system. And then the various algorithm and spatial data processing is available. You can, like me, in analyze the this flood system in using the SAR data from Sentinel-1. I use the script from UN Spider, developed in 2019. And you can use it because this is open access for you to get the sum of script that you can running. You just develop the sum of account in Google Earth Engine, and then you can use the script with permission with UN Spider, and then combine it with your area of interest or AOI that you can upload, or maybe you can trace it into the sum of Google Earth Engine software. But it depends the quality of our internet connection. So I think I suggest that if you work with Google Earth Engine, so please make sure that your internet connection is in the best condition. So, because if not, maybe there's a lag in missed data interpretation, or maybe miss loading data. So you have to prepare it first, about the internet connection. That's about the cloud computing. So I try to extracting data using Earth Engine, like that. You can copy the script. Maybe I will send the URL of the script that you can try. Maybe you want to analyze your hometown, maybe your area, or maybe your near condition of your area. So you can go with this algorithm from the UN Spider. Google Earth Engine provides us the several number of scripts also, and then several data, that a lot of data that you can access, and we can develop the model from that. So starting from the surface temperature, in 2018, I finished my dissertation about the how spatiotemporal growth, spatiotemporal urban growth, and related to surface temperature, land surface temperature. And I have to analyze before 2020. I don't know how to use the Google Earth Engine, because I prepare my dissertation with the sum of model related to QGIS by using model builder and so on. And then after I find how to use it in the Google Earth Engine, I try to analyze with the sum of surface temperature data. It's so amazing, and it's so easy to use. And you can get it in the portal of Google Earth Engine about the surface temperature. You can combine it as a planner or urban planner. You can combine or compare you're maybe in urban growth in one area and compare with land surface temperature. Is it any maybe an impact, or maybe is it dangerous for us to get the summer surface temperature that increase per year, or maybe in the 10 year is it impact from the urban growth or not? So you can analyze that, and then you can use the data climate also, yeah, for Moody's, for some of satellite imagery that provide the climate information. You can predict the runoff data and so on by using this climate data. And then the familiar one is Landsat and Sentinel. Yes, we used to use it for land cover change, and then how to assess the urban growth in some area, and then so on, related to how the anthropogenic process in the earth and surface area. Atmospheric data, weather data, MODIS, and then some several data about the morphology. So in our urban regional plannings or maybe urban regional studies, we need to explore the terrain, land cover, and some weather data. So related to the SDGs, I think this is more important about how explore further information about the Google Earth Engine, because this is the useful, and hopefully in the next course or maybe in the specific course, we can provide it for our student to get close with cloud computing in the future, especially in the Open Regional Planning Program. So after we know some of the catalog, I try to produce with that script, produce with some of spatial data that potentially flooded areas. Yes, this is automatically derived from Google Earth Engine. Yes. If you want to ask me about how the validation or how the acquisition of the model, so we have to create an analysis about that, because some of data from remote sensing need to be validated, and we have to have the additional activity about how to test the accuracy, because this is a model. No model in the world is perfect in 100%. So we need to add some activities to get the accuracy or validation of this data. After we get the data from the script from a simulation model, we can download it and then process after. Because not all process of disaster risk assessment, we can do it in the Google Earth Engine, because we need the social aspect, economic aspect that Google Earth Engine cannot do that. So we have to do that in another platform. So the model from the Google Earth Engine can help us to provide the potential disaster area, and then the affected of urban or maybe some of cropland area. Okay, this is the mapping of the sum of variables that we use in the risk disaster analysis. The left one is the four vulnerability of variable that's from the social aspect, economic, physical, and environment, and then combined with the hazard mapping that derived from SAR Sentinel-1 by using Google Earth, and combined with the settlement data, because we have to know which settlement that in the risk area or maybe in the dangerous area that we have to create the plan to evacuate or maybe to mitigate the some of people that consider to evacuate the people that maybe live or maybe some population that live there or get an activity there. And then the third is we create the map of preparedness and capacity, yeah, so based on the some community, the physical aspect, economy aspect. So we have the two of capacity map that combine in the map for the assess the capacity of the one area. So we after the develop the sum of criteria using the hazard and then vulnerability and then capacity, we like it with the some of map calculation, maybe map algebra that we can develop it by using the QGIS. I use the QGIS to combine this some variable and then illustrate it with the spatial analysis. From the map, we know that the number of the index of risk, maybe for hazard, for example, for in hazard, we know that some area of the north coastal in the red one, yeah, that inform us about the level of hazard or flood hazard in the north area of Tegal. But after combining with the vulnerability map and then the number of capacity of Tegal, we know that there are no classification in the high classification in index of risk. But we can we try to analyze the sum of settlement in the Tegal area. That's in the maybe in the mid, yeah, low up to mid index, because this is our concern about the mid index, because some area is in the mid to high index. That's maybe this is the urban area of Tegal Regency. So from the result of analysis, we know that the mitigation planning process is needed how to clarify the locus and affected area. But the most important thing is how the spatial planning can reduce the risk. With the needs, I try to compare between the spatial planning in the Tegal Regency and then with the spatial risk assessment. We know that some of settlement, maybe in the high density of settlement, is in the high risk or mid risk level of disaster. So we can evaluate and propose this or suggest for the policymaker to not only to revise but also to get the concrete or action plan about how to disaster risk reduction, especially in the area that people live there and then in the mid to high risk area. Okay, time to the before I close my speech, I will conclude that remote sensing data is very helpful in the disaster monitoring. Some field constraint can be reduced, especially from the why the researcher or maybe surveyor can still produce the data or still create the analysis about the spatial risk disaster. And then we have the problem about the accuracy data. So I want to ask Prof. Joseph, but also about the, how test the accuracy, that the best method to test the accuracy for remote sensing data, because as a planner or spatial planner, we have to create some suggestion or planning document that that can be the base data or baseline for policy making or policy maker in the some regency or maybe some area of Indonesia, that we have to propose the precision of the location and then how the model that we developed can be as consideration by public policy or maybe for the policymaker to create public policy related to the disaster risk reduction. And the last is in the planning process, the progress of remote sensing technology, especially in data gathering role and analysis stage. This is so helpful, and especially in providing a solid base for consideration, policy making process, and planning decision. So as a planner, we have to improve our knowledge, our skill in how to get the data, or maybe how to analyze from the remote sensing data, because the technology of remote sensing data is still developed. And then we have to use it for clear analysis about the spatial aspect, or maybe the anthropogenic process that give an impact for disaster. Okay, that's all about the how using the remote sensing data and combining it between the Google Earth Engine and some platform of Google Earth Engine that we can use freely for free, and then combine it with some of variable data or spatial data to determine the risk map, and we can use it to create the planning or maybe spatial planning. To get or to bring the new suggestion to our disaster risk policy. Thank you, Pak Wijanarko, and I will give back to Pak Wijanarko. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you, Dr. Anang, for comprehensive and detailed presentation about the use of Google Earth Engine as a software that can replace GIS software that we usually use to conduct a spatial analysis. Using Google Earth Engine, we can analyze any place, any field of data without downloading the data, and it can be more easier because the software can be running using the internet connection. So thank you, Dr. Anna. Well, I think the participant cannot wait to dig deeper into the remote sensing technology and its application. Maybe I will give six participants to ask about the remote sensing technology and its application, but to Prof. Yosua and Prof. Yosafat and Dr. Anna. Or maybe the participant, you may texting your question in chat room so we can read your question and deliver it to both Prof. Yosafat and Dr. Anna. Thank you. Please raise your hand if you have any question to Prof. Yosafat or Dr. Anna. Intan, maybe you can help me to identify the participant that raised their hand.
Okay, Pak Koko. Actually, we have one participant who asks to Prof. Yosafat in the chat room, Pak Koko.
Okay, maybe okay. I can directly yes. To answer. Yeah.
Okay, please, yes. Prof. Yosafat.
Okay, yes, from Ibu Sofi. Yes, the question is about, first is about the SAR imagery have the resolution is 7.5 centimeter. Yes, it is in the spatial accuracy. Okay, the spatial accuracy, yes, it is just, based on the GPS that we operated in our system. Yes, it is just, less than 10 centimeter. Yeah, actually it is 37.5 centimeter. Yes, then the resolution of our system and the spatial accuracy is about 10 centimeter. Yeah, and I think it is have a relation with the compensation. Yes, for the position offset. Yes, on the SAR antenna. GPS and then also in the inertial. Yes, this is the system. Or INU system and receiver and transmitter. Transmitter. Of course, yes. It is just a very crucial and very sensitive, you know, analysis to decide or how to get a 10 centimeter, you know, accuracy in range direction and also at the azimuth direction and also the vertical direction. Yeah, this is I didn't explain to you in detail. Yes, actually we also put several corner reflector. Yes, the corner reflector is we put the high accuracy GPS. Yes, from the geodetic GPS to decide it the position, and then based on this position is we calibrated our images, and then we got is less than 10 centimeter. Yeah. How to calibrate the position is using the corner reflector that we deployed in about 12 corner reflector. Yes, to know or to get the summary that our accuracy is 10 centimeter. Okay, I think it's enough explanation to Ibu Sofia too. Yes, it is okay for you.
I think it is okay, Prof. Yosafat. Yeah, maybe some of participants will be curious how to get the data, the CPSAR data, so they can apply it in their research for more precise in the next in the future. Okay. Maybe.
Yeah. Okay. For the CPSAR images, actually, we operated using the airborne. Yeah, it means using the aircraft. Yeah, we got several the data, and also we have the code to process the data itself from the digital data, yes, from the 0101 data, yes, to get the single look complex. Yeah, all is you can find in the books of that we will publish in December. Yeah, I hope you can provide the books, and then get the code on the software itself, and then please download the data that some of the data on the example data. Yes, we put in the the link in the book itself. Yes, I hope some of you can continue to study to do the research using the circularly polarized synthetic aperture radar images. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Prof. Yosafat, for the opportunity to download the CPSAR data for free, of course. And it is very beneficial for the student that has a limited cost in their research. Thank you, Prof. Yosafat. And the second question from Mr. Muhammad Iqbal, maybe Dr. Anang can directly answer the question from Muhammad Iqbal. Please, okay. Dr. Anang.
Ya, thank you Pak Boko. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Pak Muhammad Iqbal Habibi. Can you hear me, Pak Iqbal? Yes, I'm here.
Yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, as a planner, I work with GA as end users. So I just use the provide code by UN Spider. In the UN Spider code, the two separate pen, but I use it separately. I use it VH1 because the sum of sample code use the VH method is for commonly in GAA. And how to I build the method on disaster risk map? This map, yes, I have a reference from the our disaster National Disaster Agency for Indonesia, and then I modified it because not all variable can produce by our team. It depends on the characteristic of area. And then if I have the hazard map, disaster vulnerability map, and disaster capacity map, I create the sum of algorithm how to multiple between the hazard map and vulnerability map. And then after that, I combine it with the disaster capacity map. Like maybe I can share this PowerPoint. Like that one, Pak Iqbal. Yes, I multiple vulnerability, and then divide it with the capacity per capacity, so we can develop the disaster risk map combining between hazard vulnerability and per capacity. And then in the disaster risk theory, we can reduce the risk reduction by increasing the level of capacity. So in the capacity, we need to do the sum of primary survey to get in touch with
the community or maybe some of the policy concerning about the community development in how to preparedness or maybe some of preparation way to get the develop keep in touch with disaster. Thank you, Pak Iqbal, for the question.
Okay, thank you, Pak Anang, Dr. Anang, Mr. Iqbal.
I just said about the quote from UN Spider. Yes, that you can copy it. Yes.
Yes. For okay. to make sure the second question, so the disaster risk map. So you use that formula, then you compile it together. Is it right? Or you use?
Yes. 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 I create the summer model build using model builder first, and then I take the data from its variable, so okay. We can running it.
Okay. I thought you have to make the so like there is a disaster hazard map, then disaster vulnerable map, then capacity map, then yeah. You have to make the like a which one is the priority. I thought it's like that. Is it like that or?
Oh, no.
No.
I combine the three
of them. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Maybe I can summarize that the Google Earth Engine will produce the physical data of hazard, and then Dr. Anang produce the social data to measure the vulnerability. And measure the capacity of coping the hazard, and then combine it with the data that was produced from the Google Earth Engine, isn't it, Mr. Anang? Okay, so the Google Earth Engine is only can use produce the hazard map only, and the vulnerability and capacity data must be produced separately from the Google Earth Engine. Okay, is there any question? Okay, one question. Oh no. Okay, if there is no more question, maybe I will summarize the meeting today that we can see the radar technology that created by Prof. Yosafat is very helpful in urban and regional planning. The CPSAR data can produce more detailed and precise data that can help the urban planner or any researcher in agriculture, in military use. So it is very, very useful for the future for developing the plan better. And we can see the CBSR data is also can be obtained freely in some area maybe because there is, I think there is an area that must be prevent to obtain the data. And so all of students maybe can use the CPSAR data that produced by Prof. Yosafat to help their research in the future. And Mr. Anang, Dr. Anang has explained to us how to use the technology from Google Earth, the more easier method to conduct a spatial analysis. Especially in physical data, and then it can be combined with the spatial analysis produced by ourselves in social data that can be used to measure the vulnerability and capacity to coping the hazard. Okay, I think it is the conclusion of our lecture today. Thank you, Prof. Yosafat, for sharing your knowledge to us. It is very, very useful for us, and it helps can be contribute to our students to make a better planning, a better planning in the future. And Dr. Anang, thank you for sharing your experience in using the Google Earth Engine to measure the hazard map in Tegal Regency, and it hope it can be a knowledge for our student, so they can raise up their capability in the future. Thank you all for your participation. Maybe in the last session we can take pictures together, and Miss Intan will help me to conduct the taking the picture together.
Thank you, Pak Koko. Thank you, Pak Josafat.
Thank you, Pak Ana.
Terima kasih.
Terima kasih, Pak Josafat, atas ilmunya. Semoga bermanfaat dan berkah, Pak, bagi kami. Dan juga khusus tentu buat Pak Prof. Josafat. Semoga berkah semuanya, Pak.
Gih, matur nuwun sangat. Gih. Jangan lupa jaga kesehatannya. Kalau mau ke Ciba, silakan.
Prof. Josafat, kita ada program IUP sebenarnya. Jadi mungkin nanti mungkin ada bisa skema internship atau skema apa yang untuk spasial begitu. Mungkin siap. Sakit kan?
Bisa ya, Prof. Josafat? Selama ini dari ini, Pak, banyak, Pak. Dari UGM, kemudian dari UNUT, Universitas Negeri Padang, itu juga setiap tahun mereka mengirim rutin, Pak, ke kami. Jadi mudah-mudahan kita bisa juga create dengan ITS, ya. Undip ya, gitu.
Insya Allah ya, nanti kita langsung usahakan, Prof. Tahun depan semoga terrealisasi.
Bisa untuk master sama dokter, Pak, sekalian yang double degree program.
Boleh, Pak. Kami dari ada MPWK. Itu,
kebetulan ini ketua prodinya MPWK.
S2. Matur nuwun untuk sharingnya, dan mungkin ke depan ya, Pak, ya. Double degree ataupun mungkin exchange atau yang lain dengan mahasiswa master kami. Matur nuwun.
Matur nuwun sangat.
Monggo Mbak Intan.
Yes, for all participants, maybe you can turn on your camera. We have 3 pages, and I will start from the first page. Still waiting. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Okay, I will take the pictures. 1, 2, 3. Okay. Okay, it's already done. Thank you so much for all participants. Thank you, Prof. Josafat. Thank you, Pak Anang, and Pak Koko as our moderator today. And thank you for the lectures who delivered very insightful material for us. And we hope we can meet you all in the next international lecture series. Thank you, and wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you, everyone.
Terima kasih semuanya. Thank you very much.
Sehat-sehat, Bro.
Sehat-sehat. Semoga bisa bertemu offline, ya.
Siap-siap. Matur nuwun, Bro. Sehat-sehat.
Matur nuwun. Mohon izin, saya harus ada kegiatan lain. Sudah,
Bro. Matur nuwun. Sami-sami, Bro.